We got a new lessons that we're going to be doing. We're going to be taking a look at ourselves as the sheep of Christ's flock. So here we are. Those three. Do you want one today, Maya?
Yes.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yes. You're welcome. Okay. Oh, does Lexus want one? Sure, she can just fill in the circles, you know, all the O's or whatever. I'm all thumbs here. No, I'm not really. Did I give you three?
No.
I don't know what I did. I did something to my thumb Friday, and it's all swollen up and hurts like crazy, and I don't know what. All right, take your Bibles, if you would. Psalm 95, verse 7. Psalm 95, verse 7. What we're taking a look at this morning. The pictures that the Bible has of us as believers. Psalm 95, verse 7, it says this, "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if ye will hear his voice," and it goes on, "hearken, harden not your heart, as in the provocation, as in the day of temptation in the wilderness." Remember the people of Israel that came out of Egypt, you know, they hardened their heart and provoked God to anger. So, but we're the sheep. Isn't that something? That's what it says there, and the sheep of his hand. All right, and then take a look at Psalm 100 and verse number 3. Psalm 100 and verse 3. It says, "Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture." So, sheep, frequently the Bible mentions sheep and shepherds. It's in there quite a bit, and another word for shepherd comes from the Latin, is the word pastor. That just means shepherd. That's what it is. It's not pasture. I've been called pasture before. No. Pasture is where they graze and eat and that. But I suppose in a way, you can come and graze and eat from the word. Amen. But the pasture, he claims us lovingly, right, as his sheep. So we fill in that blank there. Christ has lovingly claimed us. Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
He claims you as his sheep. So the lesson that we're going to be taking a look at is how we as as sheep need to respond to the Good Shepherd. Who do I mean by the Good Shepherd?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ is called the Good Shepherd, right? So that's who we're going to be taking a look at. And here's what we need to do as his sheep. We need to hear his voice, we need to follow his leading, and we need to remain in his care. As sheep. Have you got any blanks there to fill in? Yeah. Okay, we need to hear his voice, follow his leading, and remain in his care. Remember, this can be on the test. And who knows when we'll get the test, right? Yeah.
Well, if the rapture occurs, does that mean we don't have to take it?
I don't know. I mean, the Lord might make you take it up there. He might give you a comprehensive test from the day that you trusted him as Savior. Boy, that'd be something, wouldn't it? Sheep, huh? Can you hear them?
Yeah.
What meaneth the bleeding of the sheep in my ears, huh? Our little flock, huh?
One black one.
One black one, yeah. Do you see the sheep? Yeah. There's the sheep, and that's what we are. That's what God sees us as, the sheep. Okay? So to do this, remember those three things, you know, to hear his voice, follow his leading, remain in his care. We do this by, are you ready? Here we go, a commitment to reading and meditating on his word. We need to do that daily. We need to read his word and think about it. You know, I get upset when I have to rush through devotions. You know, I like to read it and think about it. Say, haven't I read that? Isn't that in the New Testament? Didn't Jesus quote that there? And, you know, some of those guys. Didn't Paul write that? You know. And we also have to consecrate ourselves to faithfully following him. Faithfully following the shepherd's leading. Yeah. That's important for us to do. And then the third thing, we have to be fully convinced of God's trustworthiness, you know, to keep his promises and care for us. You know, every one of us, well, maybe the children haven't, but every one of us have had someone let us down. Isn't that true? Every one of us know of some other, you know, human that has let us down. So it's hard for us to trust God. It really can be. Now, Middle East, I know that I've not been there. If Devin were here, he'd tell us that this is true. You don't think of the Middle East as a place where big crops are growing, you know. Irrigation back then wasn't as advanced as it is today. They did understand irrigation, but not like today. Today you can go over to Israel, some of those kibbutz that they have there with the irrigation. I mean, they do grow crops. They do grow some really wonderful crops over there. But it was easier for them to raise animals, you know, than it was to raise crops. And they were part of the economy. That's how a man's wealth is, by raising crops, by raising flocks, and the size of what he owned, you know, the cattle or the sheep that he owned, the camels that he owned, that made him wealthy because of those kind of things. So, it's just amazing. Some places in the world still use cattle for money. You know, you want to buy a house, well, that'll cost you 4 goats. You know, we were in school with a gal. Her dad was a missionary in, I want to say, the Amazon, Venezuela. And good morning, Devin. Howdy. Let me get you one of these. I heard screaming, and I didn't think it was you, but I see who it is. Yeah. So we were in school with this girl named Kim, and. Kim's dad brought her out of the Amazon jungle because the natives wanted her for a wife. And, you know, she was old enough to be a wife, so he brought her out. And he didn't want to insult them. Usually you bought a wife for 1 goat. If she was really, really special, 2 goats. Her dad, Kim's dad, said to the natives was, if you want her, you have to pay me 50 goats. They said, 50 goats? And he said, well, is there another white woman here for you to buy? And they said, no. He said, white women are 50 goats. But he could see the wheels were turning. They were all trying to figure out if they pooled all their goats together, you know, could they, you know, buy her? So he sent her back to the States. But, you know, that was, you know, their money, you know, was goats.
She ended up as a missionary back there, too.
What's that?
She ended up as a missionary.
Yes, she did end up as she got married to a fellow. They went on back and as missionaries. So see if that'll work, Michael. You know, see if you can get some girlfriend. Hey, I'll give your dad a goat. You know, if you'll go out with me. You know, I don't know if that'll work or not, but you know, see what happens there with the. Maybe, yeah, he's gonna get one of them Amazon girls, you know, and he knows he's got to bring some goats down to get her. Yeah, you never know. Praise God, hallelujah. But that was the measure of their wealth, you know, and so, you know, that's you look at Job and it talks about how many sheep he had and camels he had and that kind of thing, and then you know all taken away from him, and then he's the poor man now, you know, and then God gave it all back to him, his wealth. So if he had more flocks than he could take care of, he and his sons and daughters, because I should have put daughters in there because, you know, we see Jethro's daughters taking care of the flock, then they would hire shepherds. And you know, in the New Testament, Jesus talks about the hireling being different than the shepherd. Yeah, the hireling doesn't care about the sheep, really. So the character and skill of the shepherds was important. If you're going to keep the flock, you've got to have somebody who's going to be, you know, diligent about it. And I mean, this was the man's livelihood, so he had to take care of them. Yeah. And you know that whole account in the Bible about Jacob with his uncle Laban taking care of the flock, and how, I mean, he gave Uncle Laban a big flock. I mean, he really did, but they weren't the best looking, you know, sheep, but he gave him a big flock. I mean, he really did. But you know, that's part of the idea of it. The men had to be capable and trustworthy. They really had to be. Yeah. When you think about the Lord putting, you know, men into the ministry, you know, capable, trustworthy, that's important. He's going to feed them, take care of them right. Okay? Good shepherd takes care of us. So we need not fear any harm coming to us through his ignorance or negligence. Is God ever, you know, not able to figure out the situation you're in? Yeah. And does God ever stop working for you, helping you? Does he ever stop? I don't think he does. Negligence, no. Not God. He never does those kind of things. So we're going to take a look at some principles here, how we should respond to good shepherd. So let's take a look. The first one is we're supposed to hear the shepherd's voice. And this proves some allegiance to him. We're to hear the shepherd's voice, right? Sheep need to listen. It's very important that they listen to the shepherd's voice. All right? Primary responsibility of the shepherd is to keep the sheep safe. You know? And that's why the sheep have to listen. Very, very, very important that they listen and obey the shepherd. You know, if the sheep won't go with him, they will run out of, you know, food to eat. If they won't follow the shepherd, they'll not have water, that kind of thing. I mean, they'll die out there. Yeah. It's a hostile country. Yeah. How about us with children? Any of you that know anything about children know that they need to listen and obey. Sometimes it can be life or death. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know. A small child wanders near a busy street, and you're too far away to reach them, they'd better be obedient to that word stop. It could be too late. I'm trying to remember how old I was. I want to say 10, 11, something like that. 11 years old. When we lived in the housing project, there were a lot of kids. I mean, there were 200 apartments. So there were at least 400 kids, in there. Because some families had more, some had less. So, there are a lot of kids, all kinds of kids in the projects. And so there was one group up the street. They were playing kickball. And then there was the group I was in. We were playing kickball. And somebody kicked the ball, and little Marie ran between the cars to get the ball and got killed right there. Even though we were all saying, stop, they could see the car coming on the street. And that was it for Marie. And she was, I don't remember, 6, 7, something like that, about her size. And so sometimes you need to obey, life or death situation, you need to learn to obey. So, God often sees the dangers that we don't. That's why we need to listen to him. He wants to keep us from danger, and that's important. Sheep need to listen to their shepherd, and we need to listen to our Lord and discern his voice. The Lord Jesus Christ trying to talk to us, and we need to listen to him. Oh, I was hoping that'd come out a little brighter. It's not very bright. Sorry about that. So we're supposed to constantly feed. All right? Sheep have constantly to be eating or chewing their cud. You always see sheep always chewing away. It's kind of interesting. Sheep are ruminants, as the word is. A big word for us today, ruminants, just like cattle are. And let me help you understand that. I hope I can. Their digestive process involves, several stomachs, and they have to pass through those stomachs. Now, you go to the Cornell Barns down there in Harford, and they have one of the cows. I think they have three of them, if I'm right. But I know they have one down there that they've got a window. It's like a port, like on a ship, a little round port thing. A window that looks into one of the stomachs. I don't remember which one it is. Which one? The rumen? Okay. So it looks right in there, and they can open it. When they do, oh boy. But they can take some of that out and give it to a sick cow, and it'll make the sick cow better. Quite interesting that they can do that, but they can open that window right up, take a look in there, and you can look in there and they kind of see it moving around in there. It's quite interesting if you've ever seen it. So they ruminate it. What they actually do is they bring it back up and chew it some more.
Is that because they haven't chewed it enough the first time, like I do?
Probably. Yeah, Dave. I think you've got it there. Yeah. The first time is to just kind of, get it off the ground and get it into their stomach and get the juices working. Then they just keep on working on it. So, you're asking a lot of questions of a city boy here. You ought not do that. But, it's a good picture of us and what we're supposed to do with the Word of God. That relationship that we have on it. God's words are something that we ingest into our heart and mind. And We need just the way we take in food. And the scripture talks about that. So we're going to take a look at some verses here. Y'all got everything written down that you wanted written down? Okay. Here we go. Job chapter 23 and verse 12. Job chapter 23 and verse 12. And we read here, Job chapter 23, verse number 12. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Now, is that the kind of thing that we've done? Esteemed the word of his mouth more than my necessary food? I've got to have God's word more than I have to have a meal.
Man does not live by
bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, right? That's what scripture tells us. So, I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. That's how important the word of God is. Psalm 34 and verse number 8. Psalm 34, verse number 8. And scripture tells us there, O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. When my daughter was living there in Pittsburgh, a couple Thanksgivings back, we actually brought the Thanksgiving meal down. And there was a fellow living there from Yemen, living in the same apartment building that she was in. And he'd never had anything to do with Thanksgiving. He'd heard about it, never had anything. So we, of course, invited him to come eat with us. And he'd never had turkey, never had cranberries before, and he'd never had gravy before, and
squash dressing,
pumpkin pie, none of it, you know. So we said to him, taste and see that it's good, you know, and so he did. And then he asked if he could have more. That was he liked it, you know, he liked it. So, we're to taste and see the word of the Lord, that the Lord is good. And, of course, blessed is the man that trusteth in him. And then, of course, Psalm 119, verse 103. Okay, Psalm 119, verse 103. God's word says, How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. You know, that's how God's word ought to be. It's just great. I just love God's word. Yeah, David?
When I read over John 6:53, where the Lord says, Eat my flesh and drink my blood, I was kind of tying that into it's an actual consumption of his, you know, spiritually, but
yeah,
who he is, and he is the word.
He's the word. Yeah. Yeah. Sounds good to me. Yeah. So we need to feast our souls and spirits on the words of God. How important that is. You know, and the word feast. Do you think you'd do well through the week if every day all you had was a cracker, one cracker for breakfast, one cracker for lunch, and one cracker for supper? You know, go the whole week that way, would that work out pretty good?
Especially not for you.
Yeah, especially not for me. But one cracker, that wouldn't do too well, would it? No. You know, somewhere in there we're going to eat a bigger meal. Yes? Yeah, I would hope. You know. And you need to eat the word. Some people just, you know, one verse and that's all. Not much of a meal for that day, I wouldn't think, but we need to read in the Bible. It is important for us. Will your body deteriorate if you don't have food? Yeah. Yeah. Just a few weeks back, I told you folks about that gal. Her husband had died, and she just stopped eating. She just refused to eat, and she was dead in 6 days after he died. I mean, I was just amazed. I came in and said, where's Joan? Where is she? And she died.
You know? She was so thin anyway.
Yeah, there wasn't many reserve on her, but... So our lives will wither, yes? So we have to be faithful to church and listen to the preaching, teaching of the word, a strong devotional life at home. You know, very important for you in your Christian life. You know, some churches... They have it worked out that they have, you know, like everybody does the same scripture readings through the week. And the pastor picks out something from that scripture reading in the week, and that's what he preaches on. I thought, that's an interesting thought. You know? I don't know how it would go over here in our independent, you know, Baptist church here. We're so independent, but... Yeah, it's an interesting thought. How about Paul talking to the Corinthians? He tried to teach them the basics of the Word of God, but they weren't ready yet. They're in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse number 2. God's Word tells us this, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse number 2, he says this, I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able. Now if Susan brings the little baby there this morning, you know, is she going to get, you know, hand the little baby a little chunk of, you know, steak there for it to chew on this morning, you know, or is she going to plug a bottle in?
No.
Plug a bottle in. But I'll bet you anything Alexis can have a hamburger, can't you? Yep. So you can eat that. Yeah. And I bet Michael would eat about 3 or 4 steaks every night if he could. Right? Yeah. He could. He's saying, yeah, he could. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, he said there, and I fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. Yeah, you know, the deeper teachings of the word, because you just haven't even gotten around handling the minor things. So, in the book of Hebrews, and I almost put it in that Paul wrote, because I think he wrote Hebrews. I don't think anybody else had as much depth of knowledge of the Old Testament as the Apostle Paul. But we'll find out in heaven, and that'll be all right. But in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12 through 14, it says there, For the time ye ought to be teachers... You know, you've matured so much. You know so much about the Word of God. You ought to be teachers. He says to them, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who, by reason of use, have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So if you want to know what a babe in Christ is, it's someone who has trouble discerning good and evil. That's you know, Scripture tells us right there. If you're mature... You know, you can tell, you know, you can go to the Word and say, hey, the Word says this is right and this is wrong. You know, the Word tells me that I can do this. It tells me how to stay away from this. You know, now the Word might not say it exactly, but the principle here shows me that people who went this direction were doing God's will, doing good, but people who went this direction weren't. And so even though Scripture doesn't say thou shalt not in this particular thing, I've read the Word of God enough times to know God wants me to be as holy as I possibly can. Right? So if I do this thing, it'll be holy. If I do this thing, it's got some doubt to it. I better stay away. You know, somebody said, when in doubt, don't. Yeah, that's a good idea. Should I? Well, maybe if I have to ask that question, maybe I ought not to. You know, so you know, that's being skillful as mature. But babes don't know right from wrong, good from evil. You know, babies don't know. You know, they don't know that that wall plug will hurt them. They have no idea, but they sure are interested in them, you know. I don't understand why, but it's the right eye level for them, you know. And they just like wall plugs, don't they? Yeah. They don't know that the cleansers and things underneath the sink are going to hurt them. You know, they don't know those things. They just don't know. So after a while they learn, right? So, you know, they hadn't grown beyond the baby stage, right? You know, grow beyond the baby stage. I had a gal in one of my churches call me up, I don't know how many times in a week. Pastor, should I do this? Pastor, should I do that? Should I stay away from this? What do you think? You know, well, I'm not sure. Well, did you ask your husband? Well, no, I didn't ask him. Well, what do you think he'd say? He'd say no. Well, then why are you asking me? You know, I mean, she's a babe in Christ. She really was. You know, and she'd been supposedly born again for a long, long time, but, you know, she just didn't know. She just hadn't gotten past that baby stage. Yeah. So she still required milk. And so a baby Christian, the ones that he was writing to in Corinth and Hebrews there, required milk, or the very basics. You know, what are the very basics of the Word of God? Very basics.
The gospel.
G.D. says the gospel, okay. What are some other basics? There is a God. Let me start the ball rolling. There is a God, and He created everything. Are those basic?
Yeah.
Okay.
The Ten Commandments.
Ten Commandments. Yeah. Not all 615 commandments that God gave, but the ten. Yeah. The Ten Commandments are basic. How about we're sinners? Is that basic?
Yeah.
And sin deserves hell, so that's why people who die in their sin go to hell. And that Jesus came, went to the cross, died so that we could have eternal life by trusting Him. You know, those are basics. Yeah. That's the very, very bottom line of it. So, and their palate, you know, we talk about a palate. You know, it takes some time for us to get used to some things. Here recently, our daughter introduced us to sesame leaves, and the Koreans pickle them in a certain way, hot spices in there and everything, and you're eating sesame leaves. They don't taste like sesame seeds, totally different taste, you know, and you have to, at first your body goes, I'm not sure about this. Yeah, the texture is weird, the taste is weird, it's... But then after you eat them a while, you know, with some rice, you eat them with the rice or maybe some of the meat, you know, after a while you say, wow, that's pretty good, you know. But your palate has to get to that point, you know. I wonder if we brought in a jar of kimchi which is their fermented cabbage. I wonder how many of you'd want to try it. Because I'll tell you, if I open the jar here, Raph would smell it in about 2 seconds.
Me?
You, all the way back to you. That quick.
I can't smell much.
You'd smell this.
Smell that.
You would smell this. Kimchi is distinctive. It's something. Yeah. So, but you know, you have to get a palate for that. Yeah. And handle the deeper things. So think about how sheep works on his cud here a little bit, how he ruminates it. Yeah. Do you ever notice the thoughtful look on their faces as they chew? Do you ever watch sheep chew? You know?
Sure.
Jeannie grew up on a farm. She knows. Yeah.
Feed them with a baby bottle. But yep. The hole is a lot bigger.
Feed them with a baby bottle.
Down that about 5 minutes.
Yep. We did at my aunt's goat farm the same way. Yep, feed them with a baby bottle. Yeah. So, you know, they chew and chew and chew and chew. And they don't gulp it down as fast as they can.
Yeah.
You know, they chew, quickly bring up some more and chew. You know how they do that. Now, goats are different, right? Right, David? Goats are different. They're not... They do chew a cud too? Oh, so they are pretty much the same? They'll chew and chew that kind of way? Okay. I can't, isn't that something I can't remember? You know, I guess when you're milking them, you're not looking at whether they're chewing or not. I don't know. So, you know, I like that thoughtful look on their face, you know. I don't know what they're thinking about, but, yeah. They try to get every bit of nourishment out of what they're chewing, you know. Is that how you are with the word? I hope so, you know. That's why when we eat as humans, we ought to chew our food well, get everything we can out of them. We starve ourselves by eating so fast. That's why we overeat, because we're eating so fast. Part of it.
Digest if you don't digest the mouth of the small intestine.
Yeah.
People don't understand that.
Right. Yeah. So we starve ourselves. So that's what we need to do, ruminate on God's Word. You know, think about it over and over and over again. Meditate on it. It's good for us to do. Simply reading the Bible's not enough. Just to say, yeah, my eyes looked at those words on the page, yes, and I actually read some of them. For God so loved the world. Yep, I read that. Yep. Yep, I did. I read that. Praise God. Yeah. And you ever think about it. Meditate on it. What's that mean? How can you put that in your everyday life? You know, you got to do that. If you just read it, it's not enough spiritual nourishment for you. Got to keep thinking about it over and over and over again. Yeah. I got a question for you here, all right? I'm going to ask you to raise your hand here. How many of you ate breakfast this morning? Let me see your hand. Ate breakfast this morning. Oh, that's good. Everybody raised their hand. How many of you ate something within the last 24 hours? Yep, ate something. Good. Good. That's wonderful. This next question, I'm not going to want you to raise your hand. You know, how many of you read your Bible as recently as you ate? I'm not going to have you raise your hand. You know, it says right up here. You know, it says right up here. I think I might be out of battery here. Don't raise your hands, right? Yeah. So we'll eat, but you know, I haven't got time to read the Bible today. Yeah. I told you it's a heartbreaking survey, and it's been quite a few years back now. They did a survey of pastors. How many of them had devotions? It was only like 40% had devotions. pastors. That's not good, right? Not good. God's words are necessary for our spiritual food, right? Our physical health is dependent on food, and our spiritual health depending on the words of God. Pastor, I don't know why I keep doing the same thing over and over and over again. Well, get more of the word in there. Replace that, whatever it is, with the word. You know? It's important for us. And just don't take things away, because that's bad for us. We have to replace things. The Bible always talks about replacing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think so here. I think the battery is gone. Hey, there it is. Okay. Just had a little corrosion there or something. Here's a big sentence here. Because our spiritual nourishment is even more important than our physical nourishment, we need to place spending time in God's Word even higher priority than eating lunch. Important for us. I know some people can have, what is that condition? Hypoglycemia, where they've got to eat, you know?
Yeah.
And so maybe they have to get up and eat something, otherwise they can't really even function. But
you've
got a bit of that. You have to eat something every so often. Blood sugar goes crazy on you. Yep. So, you know, I can understand, but for most of us, we can get up, read the Bible before we eat, you know. I used to tell the kids, I didn't enforce it real strongly, but I used to tell them, no Bible, no breakfast. So I used to tell them, you know, like I said, I wasn't real strict about it, but they understood what I meant. You know, gotta read. It's important for us. So here's the things to do with the word. Okay, we have to consider it carefully, ponder it, chew on it, get all you can from each passage. This morning in my devotions, I was reading about Jeremiah, where God pronounces that curse on Jeconiah. You know, calls him Coni. It won't even call him the J-E part, which is part of God's name. Won't even call him that. Mm-hmm. Calls him Coni. You know, write this man childless. You know, and how I got thinking about how that's why Jesus had to be virgin born. You know, not only because of the sin that's passed on from the Father, but also the curse of the throne. And by being virgin born, he got around that. I mean, I think about all those things. You know, just a little bit there. We need to chew on it. Okay. Need to chew on the Word of God. It's important for us. How about it? Any of you in here want to be a successful Christian?
Amen.
Yeah? Amen. Well, God told Joshua how to be a successful Christian there in Joshua 1:8. Book of Joshua, chapter 1, and verse number 8. God's word says this: "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." You know, good success, as the words that he uses right there. You know, by being in the Word of God and meditating in it day and night. You know, that's how we do that kind of thing. Okay, any questions up to this point? Any questions about the Word of God? All righty. All right, sheep, let's bow our heads and ask God to bless. Father, I thank you for being able to look at this. I thank you that you think of us as sheep, and I praise you for that. And I pray that you would continue to help, that we'd learn to listen to you and to listen to your word and to just chew on it like the animals chew on their food. I pray that you'd bless that we'd have great blessings in our morning service. You know that we need you. And so take care for us and help us for your glory. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right.